like a... We probably stand really hush-hush about what it is.
But it was like an indent... Like, he did calf raises, but, like, you could see the indentation. And I was like, that was kind of cool, but kind of weird. Like, you know, same thing happened, like, when I fractured my finger.
Probably something the college coaches are not...
Oh, no, I
crazy
about. Hey, I get that. I don't talk about injuries, you know.
No, but I mean, well, in terms of what we're talking about right now, I mean, there's discussing them on the air, and then there's discussing them so that you know what the hell's going on. There's probably a reason. You know, there's always a reason why guys end up at this
Would
level.
Would you mind, please, handwriting your name? Because we want to get your spelling, the name of your guys' the spelling of your guys' names correct for the graphics person.
But I'll say, like, Paul Marshall, because, like, you wouldn't, I don't say the second, like, when I'm on air or anything, so I'll just say. Yeah, I just say Paul Marshall, like, first and last name.
I'm really easy.
Yes.
Thanks, guys.
Yes.
Welcome.
Do I have the oath? Hold on. Let me have the oath.
Yes. Right here. Yeah, 5:15. So we'll be down.
It should work. I just can't.
No worries. You want to make your life easy.
I'm not too good at mics, but make sure to ask
me
real quick after you.
Hey, Rich, how are you?
He'll set that up.
Thank you.
So, all I know is I'm doing the coach. That's I have that worked out. I don't know.
But I might talk to you too.
Sick. I'm just kind of I'm working with you, so make sure
we'll kill it.
I don't flop.
Yeah, do you have your
I have the earpiece on. Jesse's keep me in.
Yep. I'm going to be telling you, or he'll be telling you what you need to run to or grab.
Okay, so I just listen and I'm good. Okay. Sorry, man. I just want to make sure that I got this. Thanks, man.
System points rebounds, it's fine. Most tables.
Got my mic, I'm ready, I'm set.
Cool. I haven't seen one of these since I lived in Target.
Never seen this in my life.
Doug,
that's it. I'm good.
You're good. Right.
Thanks, man. Just making sure we got this.
Good.
Make sure we don't get no hiccups.
Alright.
Yeah. And we don't want to get no Christmas. Yeah.
Oh, no worries.
It's gonna be your shadow.
Not talking shoes. Basketball yet, so you can do it.
Got some nice shoes, man.
Oh, thank you. I'm a Jordan collector.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I got over 300 pairs.
Holy shit.
Yeah, it's bad.
No, that's pretty cool, dude.
It's a bad addiction.
300 pairs.
Yeah, I'm gonna stop at 365.
Oh, wow. Still got
this wins.
I'm at 351.
That's what they all say. What? Can you hear me? You can start renting them out, man. You can make a business from that.
You already know.
Leasing them.
Tell him that.
Can you hear me? Yeah, how do I?
Yeah, I'm at
Should I go back there?
Yeah, I'm not hearing anything either.
Yeah, I'm not hearing anything.
We're not hearing anything.
Yeah, it's on.
Taking it out until it works.
Are your guys' radios not working?
No.
Yeah. Neither.
All right. Let's see if we can go get.
Okay. Sorry about that. Yeah.
Maybe they turned them on hours ago and they died, or maybe they were never operational. Okay.
Thanks.
That's the safest way.
Yeah. Can you guys talk on your microphones?
Oh,
yeah, they can. You can't. They can't.
Yeah.
Thank you. No problem. You got a cut stuff up there.
Sure. Test 1, 2.
Testing, testing.
Testing 1, 2, 3.
1 for the treble, 2 for the bass. Come on, Jam Master, let's rock this place.
New York. Unique. New York. One, two, three, four, five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Noon, good morning.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Check,
seven,
check
eight,
my
nine.
Melody. We are here live at the O'Connell Sports Complex.
That's cool. Bless it. Gotta love it.
I'd have it. I miss Mr. Magic.
Ooh. Yeah. Sounds good. Okay.
People talking, sick of all this noise, tired of all these cameras flashing, sick of being poised. I'm headed straight
this
for the
Wednesday.
Castle. They wanna make me the queen.
After 1 year, your number one place for college basketball is coming back. Live in the O'Connell Sports Center, it's time for Panther Basketball. A doubleheader that may very well change the outcome of the South Division, as the 2014 champions go head-to-head with the 2015 champion. This is the game where the Panthers will have to struggle to come out on top as the underdog or be swallowed up by the Penguins' undefeated streak. This Wednesday will be live at 5:15 from Clark College, only on Portland Sports Network.
Good evening, sports fans all across the world. Thank you for watching this exciting entertainment of NWAC action here at the O'Connell Sports Complex on the campus of Clark College. I'm Paul Marshall, that's Gard Armstrong. And whether or not this place is commonly referred to as the Igloo, whether it's not cold, we can't tell you, but we have some exciting NWAC action on the Portland Sports Network.
Yeah, these are a couple of teams who need a win very badly, Paul, particularly Portland. They have managed to sustain great effort for Coach John Slaughter for 2.5, 3 quarters of play throughout the preseason and the NWAC campaign. But when it comes to the fourth quarter, for the most part, teams have been able to overcome them with greater size, speed, and depth Today, though, they may have a chance against the Clark Penguins, but when you come up against the Clark Penguins, you're seeing a lot of shooters and a lot of depth as well.
Now for the Clark Penguins, this marks their first time in the South Division. Both these schools have played each other, but now these games have more meaning. And number two, this is the second time these teams will face each other. And also, if you're looking for a list of three, Clark is also on a three-game winning streak, so maybe the Panthers perhaps do have something to say to counteract the momentum that the Penguins have gone on so far.
Absolutely. The coach, Al Aldridge, was a legendary coach here in Washington High School basketball, took the program over here at Clark a few years ago, and he's got some players who really play well from end to end, 94 feet across the floor. For Portland, it's going to be important for Angelique Williams to continue to score 25 or more. She'll need help from Cheyenne Akles, who has been bothered by injury. Cache Bynum also has had problems with injury, but both apparently are back and ready to go against the likes of Brianne Nwekwu and Kendall Cohn and some of the other excellent players that Clark has on their squad as all of these teams try to reach toward the mighty Lane Titans in this tough NWAC schedule.
That is the pacemaker, and tonight we did speak with both Cheyenne and Cache, and they said they're good to go. They wouldn't want to miss a game like this because now everything is on the line. Even though it's the fourth game within the division, these games are much more important, and that's what we'll have tonight here on Portland Sports Network.
Yes, and what we're looking for, if you're the Portland Panthers, is an opportunity to go back to the state tournament. Amazingly getting there last season, Coach John Slaughter seems to figure out how to get this team moving in the right direction toward the end, toward tournament time in mid-March. The tournament is in Everett this year. For Clark, they think that they can play well enough to get in, but now it's a matter of going up against the top teams. I wouldn't say Portland is an absolute test for Clark, but Portland feels that they can beat Clark. So we've got two teams that really want it here tonight.
And this game will indeed serve as an early barometer for what these teams can do. As last year, the Portland Panthers did make the playoffs, as well as the Clark Penguins. So these teams know about postseason experience. They understand that it is not a sprint. It is indeed a marathon. And this is the test for that marathon.
Yes, and with Clark winning the men's title last year, that probably only spurs the women's program on further to try to match that kind of success. Of course, we've got a very good matchup in the men's game as well coming up, with the last two NWAC champions taking the floor in the Panthers and the Penguins on the men's side. But we've got some very good basketball coming up here first on the women's side.
Yes, we do. We have the women's game coming up first, and at 7:30 you have the men's game. And I'm sure just like the women, the men also have something to prove. And stay with us on Portland Sports Network, where we're going to have more NWAC action on the Portland Sports Network, because we're back.
with that tip, we are underway here at the O'Connell Sports Complex. Penguins in their white uniforms. Cone, Newsom, Nueku, Franklin, and Strandberg are your starters. For your Panthers, Banks, Williams, Bynum, Stanley, and Akles. And the Penguins quickly open up with a three-point barrage.
That's an example of what you'll see right there from Angelique Williams. She'll try to force contact in the lane, get to the free throw line. She's averaged over 25 points a game since becoming eligible for Portland. And that first possession is a microcosm of what we're going to see a lot of this evening.
Speaking with Coach Aldridge, he said we've got to eliminate Akles and Williams, keep them from scoring, and have other people work. And that right there is a testament to that. As the Panthers get the ball back,
having Mary Banks bring the ball up the court to alleviate some of the pressure off Williams, who's played about 37 minutes a game, rarely takes a break, and not walking the ball up will give her a few more breaths.
And Akles inside is able to knife her way for an early basket.
Be interesting to see if they double Akles down low, if they zone her, or if they go player to player if you're out.
Sierra Stanley, one of the leading rebounders for this Panther squad, secures another one. For three, no good. The rebound cleared by Banks as she looks to reset. The possession will remain with the Panthers.
Well, neither of their first two attempts that made it to the backboard hit the rim, so they've only got 1 second left on the 30-second shot clock to try to muster something. You want a lob, a catch, and a shot here, according to John Slaughter, who's yelling just that from the bench.
That shot did hit the rim at 8:10 early in this quarter, but the Penguins are able to take it out. Open look, no good. Akles will look with push tempo. Aldridge talked earlier, getting the ball out of her hands, and the Panthers are a very optimistic team, and that to counter those, you have to control their tempo.
Jump balls, you see that a lot in the women's game. You also saw a contested but honest opportunity for Bynum there at the rim, right block. You want to convert that if you're Portland.
Angelique gets the steal, and she's fouled by Brianne Nueku. That's her first, and she will earn a trip to the charity stripe. Williams, that is.
Williams shooting 73% this year. This is not a Portland team that shoots particularly well from the line, especially Akles.
Misses the first.
And that has cost them in games, but the opportunism that Williams showed right there and picking up the steal and getting to the basket, that's going to be the bread and butter for the Panthers this evening.
Williams, who was second on the team in free throw percentage, comes up empty on a pair. But she gets a steal again. And Angelique gets those two to go. And that quickly forces a timeout by Coach Aldridge. 30-second timeout from the Penguins.
Pardon me, Paul. Yeah, Al Aldridge does not like what he's seeing so far, particularly when you get two early steals in the backcourt. You're unable to break the press. And that's giving Portland hope that they can stick around in this one. So Aldridge is probably telling his players, I need to see more effort and more focus. Let's get the ball into the front court, run our offense, and play our game. When they've done that, they've gotten wide open looks from free to start the contest.
Before the game, I had an opportunity to talk with assistant coach Nicolette Bond, a former player of the Clark College Penguins, and she said one of the things that she's learned from being a coach rather than a player is that the intensity level that Al demands from his players is often different, and it's one of those things that you don't see, but during that timeout, we're sure to see something different, contingent upon Coach Aldridge's direction. Penguins work the ball around. 10 seconds on the shot clock. And another steal by the Panthers. Mary Banks looks to push tempo. Recovered by Williams as she looks to reset the offense. Hoist up a three. Rebound cleared by Newsome as she looks to bring it up the floor. 6:40 in the first quarter. Panthers lead 4-3. That shot by the Penguins is no good, but there's a foul on the play.
There's where Mike comes into play. Strandberg, who has done a lot of great work down low for them this year, averaging 6 rebounds a game, and an excellent free throw shooter as well. Breaks that one up.
Substitution for the Penguins. Bryn Tennyson is checking into the game for Kendall Cohn.
Tennyson's the best of the free throw shooters on this team. She hasn't missed this year. But this is when the size comes into play. The second chance is that was a bad three-point miss, but an easy weak side rebound because of the height advantage.
And Strandberg, a 64% free throw shooter, comes empty on a pair. And another opportunity for the Panthers as they lead by one with 6:30 in the first quarter. And that's recovered by the Penguins, and they have numbers as they look to push. And Strandberg was able to avoid the swatting arm of Bynum to put the Penguins up by one, 5-4, with 6 minutes in the first quarter.
Most of the offense in this game has been created by steals at both ends.
And that tip pass by the Penguins will reset the Panthers' offense down low. Siva Isaiah is checking in the game for the Panthers for number three, Sierra Stanley.
And she'll give the height to this lineup for John Slaughter and the Panthers. The issue is, can she keep out of foul trouble?
And Akles on the give and go inside. You know, in basketball, they say the most dangerous person is the one who just inbounded it. And there's an example right there. And another batted pass by the Panthers. But a steal by Brian Nueku. It's always a good sign early to see Coach Slaughter being energetic and getting on his players and all the surrounding circumstances. It's always good to see that early.
I don't think that anybody has to worry about him doing that. A lot of missed free throws early in this game, Paul. That is not what either coach wants to see. The fans don't want to see it, and the players standing here at the free throw line leaving money on the table is often said. They don't want to see it either.
And Nueko makes the second. Checking in for the Panthers, number 20, Mariah Carpenter, a freshman from De La Salle North Catholic High School here in Portland, Oregon.
Unforced error created by the trap. And will they trap up high or trap down low? Right now, the trap at the wings is paying dividends for Clark's defense.
And Carpenter is able to come away with that rebound underneath. Akles faces a double team, goes behind the back, looks to split. But that's a turnover by the Panthers. And Newsome with the step through for an easy two to put the Penguins up 8-6 with 4:46 left in this first quarter.
Well, John Slaughter is going to tell his team, why was nobody stopping the ball on that occasion? I mean, yes, the move was nice, but we need to have someone stopping the dribble drive, forcing her to shoot or to kick. And neither happened. And a basket that certainly looks good on tape, but when you run back the tape, you're going to see where Portland's defensive scheme was deficient on that possession.
So much of what Portland's going to try to do today is remain physical and try to take Clark out of their motion offense and drive to the basket and get fouls and get players in foul trouble.
And the Panthers are forced to take a timeout. There was an early sign of an injury. I believe it was number 23, Cheyenne Akles, and they'll have to tend to that.
Well, her shoulder's been bothering her all year, and we were told she was ready to go, but it may not still be 100%. We'll see.
She said Monday she wasn't feeling well, but Tuesday she went to go get an MRI, and she said she'd feel better by then. And she said she'd give it a try today. And the Panthers turn it over again. And Bynum chins that rebound.
Love the explosiveness for the second straight possession by Newsom to the basket. Just couldn't finish that one.
Newsom scored a season-high 24 points against Lane, so if there's anything we know, she can be explode for points. Banks will fire a three. That's off the mark.
Putting up that many points against the Titans, that should be impressive for anybody who's had a look at how the NWAC has played out the last couple of years.
And the Panthers' defense forces another turnover.
Again, Williams is an excellent scoring threat, very quick, very agile, but she needs Akles out there as her foil. And with the two of them, Portland, despite the size deficiency, can play with almost anybody in this league for at least a while. But without Akles, things sort of become one-dimensional. Portland is not good at hitting the three either once they fall behind.
Kendall Cohn checking into the game for the Penguins as the Panthers look to swing it around.
And Paul, you and I were present for Portland's last game against Umpqua. Siva Isaiah left a lot of points out there at the rim when she was open. We saw another example of it right there. She's great at grabbing the rebound, anticipating the angle, but is just not finishing the layups, and it's got to be as frustrating for her as anybody.
Last season when Coach Slaughter won the opportunity to go to the playoffs, he said, I had all guards, no bigs. And one of the things he said is we want to get Siva to the point where she's getting comfortable more inside, and I think they're trying to do that as well as keep steady with their guard play.
Nice lob inside there to Cone, by the way.
Williams faces a double. I don't think that pass was intentional.
No. Usually when I'm reffing and they throw the ball at me, it's on purpose. But you see what Clark is doing. They're trapping up high because they don't believe that Portland's guard play and ability to pass the ball around, especially when Williams doesn't have help, is the right way to go. They want to trap up high as they're doing here and not even let Portland get off a decent shot.
Angelique dribbles through a couple crowds. And Carpenter inside by herself.
Doesn't score much, but has been a good spot player in a year when Slaughter has not often had his full rotation.
And Cohn is able to knife inside for a floater.
She's averaging 9 points a game in the seat. Last two times she's been down there, once on the inbounds play, and once there on the drive straight down the middle, she's converted.
12-8, Penguins lead, 2-10 in the first quarter. You have to commend the Penguins early. They've got good spacing and very patient ball movement. And that really's kind of thrown off the Panther defense for a bit of a spin.
Well, again, matter of keeping your player in front as you see Akles back in the game. She's been dealing with a lot of issues, but is going to try it out here and getting herself to the line.
Akles, a 38% free throw shooter, misses the first. Checking in for the Penguins, Brynn Tennyson for Molly Franklin.
both teams employing substitution tactics early to give their players much-needed rest. And that second one bricks home to cut the deficit to a one-possession game with 1:45 left here in the fourth. The first correction.
Second chance opportunities have helped out Clark here. They're grabbing a lot of offensive rebounds. You saw Tennyson hoist one right there. She's one of the two leading three-point shooters on the team, along with Nweku. They both shoot about 40% from three, so they've probably got free reign to hoist it up there anytime they like.
Newsom was fouled, has earned herself another trip to the free throw line. She connects on the first. Newsom, one of several Oregonians on this Clark roster, a sophomore from Grant High School.
And so well familiar with Mary Banks, a freshman from Grant for Portland. There's Nweku. If they have the open look, they're going to take it, because if they can go on a hot streak, they can gain some separation, which is what they want to do early, take Portland out of the game.
1 minute left in this first quarter. The Clark Penguins hold a 13-9 advantage over the PCC Panthers. And the Panthers turn it over again. Newsom on the attack, flips it. And that cone layup is good.
Cone with 6 points as we wind down in this first quarter. She has taken care of every opportunity she's gotten around the rim.
Rebound secured by the Penguins. The Penguins really have a perimeter-oriented attack, and they're able to get some points inside easily because of their ability to spread it around outside.
The second chances have just got to be killing John Slaughter inside. I love the hustle that Cone and Newsom have shown underneath and working their way to these second chances, getting trips to the line, and here again with the lack of size, foul difficulty is going to become an immediate issue for the Panthers.
Cone misses the first. Substitutions for both the Panthers and the Penguins, Livia Strandberg and number 32, Mary Banks. And for those watching on YouTube, Portland Sports Network, thank you, and we will continue to have more action. This is only game one of an intense doubleheader between the Clark Penguins and the Portland Community College Panthers.
Cone is a lot like Akles. Cone does not shoot well from the line, 50% of the year coming in, and both teams have left a lot out there from the free throw line in this first quarter, which has changed the dynamic.
And that's your first quarter. Williams was trying to lead Isaiah with that pass, but it was a little bit too strong. And after one, the Clark Penguins lead 15, the PCC Panthers lead by 9. Scott, a lot of missed free throws. Does that seem normal, or is this a little bit the outlier, so to speak?
I don't think it's the outlier. Both these teams are okay from the free throw line. In this day and age, a lot of teams don't shoot well from the free throw line, but in the women's game, it's ever so more important when you begin to climb deep into the foul count, and that can be a huge factor. By my hand here on the score sheet here at our broadcast position, Clark missed 6 free throws in 8 attempts in that first period. They're a 67% shooting team from there. But also, they weren't very good from three. You had that early three from Nweku, and then nothing after that. Several air balls, several tough looks, and it's more difficult to explain when it's your home gym. You're used to shooting here all the time. Sometimes they say visiting players, hey, it takes them a little while to get into the flow of shooting in an opponent's gym. Well, I don't think that either team has that excuse, because these two programs are so close to each other, and there's got to be a little familiarity for a lot of the Panther players in this arena. But Portland's shooting percentage from outside wasn't its problem in the first quarter. The turnovers were the issue, the offensive rebounds were the issue, and then not finishing the layups when they did come around. And if Akles isn't able to provide full minutes this evening, it could be trouble, but she's out here to start the second period.
Coach Slaughter, second year man at the helm of the PCC Panthers, who last season took the Panthers to the playoffs for the first time in school history with an overall record of 13-13 and a conference record of 6-6. So building on that experience, he looks to develop this program even further. And Strandberg is able to get inside for a layup.
Off the lob from Tennyson, and right there an excellent seal against Isaiah on the post. Isaiah didn't seem to know the lob was coming.
Isaiah misses the layup. Cleared out by the Penguins. And that Newsome layup prompts a 30-second timeout by Coach John Slaughter.
Cohn led the Penguins with 6 in the first period. Strandberg now has 4. Newsome now has 5. And Nweku with 4 points for Clark. And I believe Coach Aldridge mentioned to you prior to tip-off, it was important for the tempo to get up there, to get out in front of the Portland transition defense. We saw a lot of that in the Umpqua game a few days ago. Portland did not get back, and it led to a lot of easy baskets for the Riverhawks. And we're seeing a little bit more of that here to open the second quarter. Portland's just got to turn and run and force Clark to establish the perimeter motion offense instead of getting these transition buckets.
Aldridge says that the Panthers are a very opportunistic team in that they will take advantage. And talking to Coach Slaughter as I visited their practice on Monday, that Umpqua Community College, they didn't do anything special, really. They just kind of fast break us, and we didn't have the energy to get back on defense, and that was a huge killer. And that foul is charged to 21, Brent Tennyson with the pushing.
Maybe some of our audience not familiar with the women's game. Some changes this year. They now play 4 10-minute quarters instead of 2 20-minute halves, and the foul count resets each period.
And Angelique Williams double gathers that shot, and she's able to lay it up in.
Player who understands angles well. And right now, right there, she saw that there was an open angle there on the left side of the lane, and no Clark defender was able to step up and take away the open look at the layup.
Ten to shoot on the shot clock. That Penguin patience has really flustered this Panthers. As you see, Nweko is able to bring the ball out, space the floor, is able to get the post players good looks.
And that's frustrating for Portland's defense with the shot clock winding down. They're doubling Strandberg in the post, and she's still able to make the easy catch and get herself a trip to the free throw line.
Checking in for the Penguins, number 24, Monique Washington, a sophomore from South Jordan, Utah, Bingham High School. And Strandberg makes the second. Penguins holding on to a 9-point lead at 8:35 in the second quarter.
The Portland basket by Williams on this end a moment ago broke a 7-0 run for Clark. And so they've got to try to maintain relevance here, maintain contact, keep it within 2 or 3 possessions.
As that pass was deflected, we're very thankful that it didn't hit our cameraman down there. That was a bullet.
A lot of giveaways in transition for both teams in the first half.
And that shot is turned away. And Akles says, I'll take that, and I'm going back the other way. And Akles with a little shimmy, shimmy, yeah, to bring the deficit to 7. 7:50 in the second quarter. Angelique Williams, in the words of DJ Khaled, another one. And that deficit is now down to 5, 7:30 in this second quarter.
Well, they're looking into the post first, but then they're telegraphing the pass up to the top of the key when they reset the motion offense, and that's just not the tempo that Coach Aldridge wants. He wants a crisper pass. He wants one that isn't obvious to create this steal. Here's another one for Akles.
How about a list of three? That's three in a row. And Akles will score as she clapped back and says, and one. We've got a one-possession game here with 7 minutes in this second quarter.
It's a 6-0 run for Portland. You understand why Al Aldridge makes substitutions here. His team's playing out of control on offense. They seem to have been taken out of their rhythm by Portland's opportunism. And just like that, that burst keeps them relevant, keeps them in contact, as I said, and now it's a one-possession game. One thing we've also been seeing, Paul, is Williams' ever willingness to shoot the three-pointer. Doesn't matter how many she's missed, she's going to keep shooting them. She's 30% on the year from out there, but if she can get into a hot streak, that causes problems for her opponent.
Well, Moochie Norris, as she's affectionately referred to in practice, she's only played in 6 games this year, but she's already ranking first in the conference with 28 points a game. So although it's only 6 games, it could be considered an aberration. There's some validity to that number.
Great work at both ends here from Aliki. First the block at this end, and then to pick up the second opportunity and go to the line.
Good on the first by Aliki. Checking in for the Panthers, number 20, Mariah Carpenter. For number 11, Cache Bynum.
Leakey is the best regular free throw shooter on the team at over 80%. The confident free throw shooters, they get rolls like that. And you saw it right there on her second try.
And as we see the PCC men's team file in, their game will be immediately following this one on Portland Sports Network. And Mary Banks says, I'll take that opportunity. And she trims it now, 22-20, the Penguins lead, 6-10 in the second quarter.
Portland bench didn't agree with that call against Mariah Carpenter. That's going to send Washington to the line. Banks is good for one or two of those a game, the spot up three. She's got to have her feet set. She's got to be in position. But Shirley Clark was told about that in the scouting report. They're going to try to get the ball to her for a spot up. So when she has time, she's actually the most consistent three-point shooter that I've watched. The fact that Williams shoots a lot in volume doesn't necessarily mean she's going to hit a lot of them.
And Washington is successful in a pair.
At 75%, and that only boosts her average. So 4 free throws in a row staunched that 6-0 run for PCC.
No whistle on that scrum.
Well, down here at this end, you saw good defensive positioning on the part of Cohn and Aliki. They just held their ground. They didn't shift their hips or step into the shooter. And if the offensive player tries to initiate that kind of contact, it's a good no call.
Substitutions for both the Penguins and the Panthers. Number one, Shakira Jackson. And 21, Bryn Tennyson for the Penguins. It looked as if the referees changed their mind at the last second. It was Panther basketball, but it got deferred to Penguin basketball. And that's taken away. Kendall Cohn says, I'll take that and put this up there.
Akles had done well to pull the rebound, but then Cohn saw that she wasn't protecting the ball coming up to start the other way. Well, on plays like that, when maybe the referees didn't have the best look, you tend to give the ball to the defense, and I would have done the same thing.
5-15, second quarter. Penguins lead 26-20 here at the O'Connell Sports Complex. Akles gets the ball, stops. And that ball is tipped off of Akles. It's another Panther turnover.
She's just not being secure with the ball. Clark is seeing that and kind of picking her pocket on two consecutive occasions there. Meantime with Clark, and it's usually Cone, player who has the ball there at the head of the key, has got to be more secure with it, more sure of it in the triple threat. Portland wouldn't come up with all of these steals if you kept your head on a swivel a little bit more and was aware of who was around you to try to take the ball away. I'm a little surprised at how poor the perimeter passing has been for Clark. Once Portland figured out that, hey, we can go out and steal this ball, they have done a lot of it. In the first couple of minutes, they were a little more timid about that. Now they're being more resolute to go out and try to intercept that pass, and Clark's giving them a lot of help.
That poor passing is not a mantra of Coach Aldridge's teams, who pride themselves on being disciplined and playing aggressive defense. And Alecki is able to knife inside on the post possession. 28-20, 4:29 in the second quarter.
And there you saw Aldridge's offense run the way it's supposed to be run, where you get the mismatch. Stanley can't do anything about it, and Alecki is able to knock that one in.
And Cone had quickly put her hands behind her back as if to say, they weren't talking about me.
Mike Pereira, the officiating guru, now heard on Fox Television, longtime vice president of officials in the NFL, often says to his audience, you know, when the player puts his or her hands up in the air like that, 9 times out of 10, they were guilty. And that is true. Good positioning there as well for Alecki on the rebound over Isaiah.
Isaiah for the Panthers is looking to deny the post entry. But Molly Franklin is able to come up with that possession and pushes the Penguin lead to 10. 30-20 with 3:35 in the second quarter.
Their largest lead, and again, Alecki being active, saving that ball and tipping it right to her teammate for the layup.
A quick shot by Carpenter.
Coach Slaughter telling Isaiah, you can't go through the player. If they've boxed you out, they've boxed you out, and that's just a silly foul to give away. Put Tennyson, who hasn't missed a free throw this year, on the free throw line.
Coach Slaughter has taken off his jacket. Fair to say he's getting more comfortable and he's getting more intense as the game goes on. Tennyson misses the first.
Was that the announcer's jinx? I don't believe in it, but Brett Bielema on the megacast of the national championship college football game the other night, the coach of Arkansas, said after a field goal was missed by the Alabama Crimson Tide, said, oh, I just jinxed him. He mentioned how good the field goal kicker was for Alabama.
That was a game, was it not?
It was a game. As good as the one that had been hyped from 10 years ago, USC and Texas. I think it was every bit the game that one was.
Williams has earned her opportunity for a pair at the charity stripe.
And Tennyson, understanding that she can't allow Williams to score there, does her job well, hard but clean foul, and then offers to help the player up. That's the kind of sportsmanship you want.
And I was talking to the third member of our crew, Iggy Da, who will be with us for the halftime interview. And I was saying how in basketball, it's kind of the same thing. If you know someone is going to dunk on you, you'd rather foul them and say, look, I appreciate your athleticism, but you're going to have to earn the trip from the line. And, you know, you look at a situation like that where Williams has a layup, and they said, hey, we're going to put you on the line, see if you can really earn it. Here in the second quarter. Reminder that at the conclusion of this quarter, we will have a halftime interview conducted by the third member of this crew, Iggy Da.
next foul both ways means free throws here for the remainder of the half.
And Akles slices and dice for the competition, so they'll pay the price as it's 30-23. Panthers slowly working into that lead. And a bump foul by Angelique Williams. She was very intense on the defense with that slight nudge at the end. .230 remaining in this second quarter, 31-23, Penguins lead. Thank you for watching on Portland Sports Network. And remember, you can tweet us or subscribe to the channel on YouTube. Thank you so much for watching with us. And Angelique Williams finishes with the left.
What's kept Portland in this half is that Akles has been the complement to Williams. Williams has 7 points here in the second quarter. Akles has six, and that's the 1-2 punch that John Slaughter is looking for to keep his team in games for four quarters.
As we look over to our right, we see the band filling in and putting the music in front of stands, and looks like they're ready for some more action. As Carpenter comes away with that. Under 2 minutes now. Akles looking to push tempo, but that's turned over. And Newsom with another deuce.
I have it for 9 points in this half.
As we will at halftime, we'll check all the stats.
I don't have Williams for making a single three in this half, but she is never one to be gun shy. She'll keep throwing him up there.
Perhaps that was one too many passes for the Panthers.
Well, I mean, if they want to pass more, that's fine, but it's got to be a meaningful pass. So I was going to say about Carpenter, you know, she comes in and plays these spot minutes, and they've got to be meaningful minutes. She creates a steal as soon as she checks into the game, and when you're a player who's 6th, 7th, 8th in the rotation, that's the kind of reputation you want, someone who makes things happen. There, Clark was a little too obvious with one to lob the ball inside.
1 minute remaining till halftime, 34-25. Penguins looking to add.
Interesting to see what the shooting numbers are like in this half. Again, Portland's not been good from three, but Clark hasn't been nearly as good as they'd like to be from three. Season-wise, in terms of their average, they're playing at home, they're getting open looks. But they've also converted around the rim, whereas Portland has failed to do so on many occasions.
Shot clock is turned off. Williams will pull back out. Angelique looks to go. .1 on the clock for the Panthers.
Well, here's the issue, is that you don't even have enough time for a tap. This has literally got to be a lob to the basket and a tap off a hand. It can't be anything else. A catch ends the period. See, that's not going to get it done by rule, even if that goes in.
No good in your halftime score. Clark Penguins, 34. PCC Panthers, 25. Now let's send it to the third member of our team, Iggy Da, as he's with Coach Alan Aldridge.
Am I good? So this is Portland Sports Network. My name's Iggy.
It's Al Aldridge.
How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing good.
How do you think your team did so far?
We're playing really sloppy. I'm not very happy. Not executing our sets correctly. Lack a little intensity on defense and missing too many free throws.
What do you think your team could do better on next quarter?
Well, we got to execute on offense. We're going to talk about that in there. We got some kids that didn't come to play today. They got to step up.
Yeah. The band's pretty loud today. Huh? It's hard to hear. Yeah,
really hard to hear.
Yeah. So what was your favorite play?
My favorite play? Probably the drop step on Chantel Alike in the block for a nice score on the baseline.
Nice. So what does the next half look like to you?
Well, we're going to have to continue to put a little more pressure on them and execute better on offense. Same stuff.
So do you think you're going to win?
Yeah, I think we're going to be okay.
Probably a pretty bad question.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It's Portland Sports Network, the city coming to you live.
Welcome to another episode of Oh My God. Today, I decided to take a break from driving and use public transportation. Watching another episode of Oh My God. Next time you want to save on gas or not feel like driving, take the public transportation. It'll get you somewhere.
Ways to influence a positive day. Positive thoughts and attitudes can help us overcome negative vibes. Try these suggestions to brighten up even the gloomiest day. Step 1. Give yourself a pep talk. Remind yourself of your past successes and how you can repeat them in the present and future. Step 2. Reach out to others. Making a human connection, either in person or by phone, can lighten your load and that of your friends and family. Step 3. Say something nice to someone. Sharing a compliment is an easy, positive means of sharing support. Step 4. Escape through a good book. The simple act of immersing yourself in another reality can relieve stress and encourage a fresh perspective. Step 5. Smile at someone. You're likely to receive a smile in return. Step 6. Have a massage. Self-care is not selfishness unless taken to the extreme. An occasional treat of having someone focus on just you can revitalize your energy levels. Step 7. Cool the alcohol consumption. Numbing ourselves with alcohol does not help to alleviate problems. Keep a clear head to combat negativity. Don't just cover it up. Step 8. Pet a pet. Numerous studies have proven that the simple act of petting an animal results in warm feelings in humans. don't own a pet? Volunteer at a shelter, visit a friend's pet, or keep some animal pictures close by that bring on a smile. Step 9, go outside. Feel the simple pleasures of the earth, the sun, the breeze. Fresh air clears the head, boosts the spirit, and can provide a good dose of vitamin D. Step 10, allow your own spirituality to brighten your day. Regardless of your personal definition of spirituality, it can provide strength, a deeper awareness of connection with others, a higher set of values, and put your life in perspective.
Portland soccer is a great community.
To have an opportunity to go to those stadiums and see that energy and that atmosphere.
Yeah, Portland's nice. It's going to the Timbers games and being able to like go see like what's next.
And people saying, well, it's going to be here in another 10 years. Soccer's going to happen. And now it is here, and it's coming quick. Here that they understand that effort and hard work is actually fun, that by working hard there's reward at the end of that, and that reward can be winning, but it's also a really good performance, and they enjoy getting better and improving And that's what we get here, because our environment is competitive, but it's also enjoyable. It's disciplined and it's structured, but there's also freedom for creativity.
Just that feeling of going and showing up at practice, and it just felt professional. It was a high level, like it was intense. It was just thing after another. He would explain them so well, and he was really good at guiding us and instructing us, getting us better. Like, he really formed a team last year.
Character reveals itself in the environment that you create. So our training sessions are extremely intense. We are always trying to play to a winner. Putting them in and under as much pressure as they're going to find in a game is one of the ways that you can test players' character and see what they're all about. The technical side, the fundamental aspects and the core skills that you need to attack and defend are something that we work on a daily basis. I want players who want to come here and be professional players, kids that really want to go on to the next level. Our environment is as professional as I can make it, based on my experiences of having worked at the professional level. And we want kids that want to come here and move on to D1 school. I like my teams to possess the ball. I want to be in possession of the ball more than not. But it also depends on the team that you're playing against. We want to build our attacks from the goalkeeper forward and play through the thirds of the field. We have to understand when and what parts of the game we want to play a certain way. But I believe in a very dynamic, free-flowing passing style. So not just running around and working hard, but looking for players that understand the ebb and flow of a match. Don't quit. Treat teammates with respect. Understand what discipline is. They're on time. They're grown up. They don't whine. They don't complain. They don't moan. They get on with the work that's being placed in front of them. We have a philosophy at the Washington Timbers and at Clark College, and character is the most important thing. It's the foundation on which everything that we do exists. We believe that character drives the process, and the process is what drives whether you're successful at winning things. And without character, you can't drive a process. The human connection that you have with players, young men who are trying to get somewhere in life, at this age is sometimes a difficult pathway to navigate. I enjoy getting to know them, and I enjoy getting to work with them and really try and stretch them as athletes and get the best out of them and maybe show them something that they didn't know about themselves.
They have been there 100% of the way. I actually had gotten their surgery through Clark College. They had actually covered my insurance, which I am very grateful for, because I did not have any health insurance. And well, I tore my meniscus, but and that's the thing, it was a quick recovery, and I had support the whole way through from Ann, from Brett, from Jason, from the whole team. Like, I really felt cared about and special. Like, it was really nice.
We'll be right back.
And Banks misses that layup, but Williams on the second. And she's able to get it in on the second attempt, which now brings the deficit 34-29 as the Panthers look to trim away at this lead with 9 minutes into the third quarter.
So sure enough, the two players who have meant the most to them, Akles and Williams, have played the biggest factor, and they score the first 4 points of this half to cut that 9-point lead to 5, as Paul said.
Taking a look at the head-to-head statistics, since 2003-2004, these teams before, now they're in the same division, they've played each other except for 3 years, but Clark has come victorious 6 times out of 2. Now with both teams in the same division, each game against each other now means more. As Bynum takes away that pass, gives it up to Akles, who gives it to Banks, and it's now to a 3-point game with 8:30 in this third quarter. Patient ball moving by the Penguins. Give and go. For three. Got it. Brenda Nueku, she drains that in. The Clark College Athlete of the Week on January 7th. She's primed for big game moments.
Well, two of the players who put in the most work on the boards in the first half. Chantel Alecki with 7 boards for Clark. Akles with 7 for Portland. Clark out-rebounded Portland 26-20. Clark shot 40% from the field. Portland shot 32%, so a little better clip than I had thought. But Portland 1 of 11 from 3. Clark 1 of 9 from 3.
And that's a pair of free throws to trim this deficit to 4 with under 8 minutes to go in the third quarter. Carpenter checks into the game for Banks.
Franklin and Strandberg have 2 fouls apiece for Clark. That's 3 now on Banks.
Jump ball. Possession will remain with the Penguins underneath. Banks with those 3 fouls is something I assume Coach Slaughter will keep an eye on, but that does kind of hurt their rotation.
It does, but not as much as, say, if Isaiah picks up her third. She, Bynum, and Carpenter all have 2 fouls right now for the Panthers.
And Akles tries to thread that needle, but it'll remain with the Panthers.
When Isaiah picked up her third against Umpqua, that made a huge difference in terms of the rotation Slaughter was able to play, and that was a team that's even taller than Clark.
Siva, who has recorded 2 double-doubles in the season, will be looking for her third tonight.
She does not score in the first half, and they're going to need a little more production out of her in this half if they want to stay relevant for all 40 minutes. I'm going to guess that that's Newsom's favorite shot in practice and in games too from the corner, because she has had no hesitation taking it, much as Williams. Anywhere on the wings or at the top of the key will launch the three from pretty much any distance within 25 feet. So the two of them have been cold though. There's the primary 3-point threats for each team. That has had a factor in what our score is right now.
I guess the equivalent of Newsom's corner shot would be if you're playing a game of horse, that one person who always knows that behind the backboard, they'll make it. As Barbara Leone comes in and drains a three. Now it's down to a 1-possession game. Panthers are looking to scratch back in this one.
She's the other good spot shooter besides Banks.
Angelique Williams with the steal. Bynum, count the basket. She's earned herself a trip to the line.
She didn't score in the first half either, and so they've come out with a renewed sense of purpose and are taking the fight to the Penguins here. And they've been able to turn a 9-point deficit at halftime into, at the moment, a 1-point lead.
Now, following Saturday's game against Umpqua Community College, Bynum said she came down with a double whammy of dehydration and food poisoning. And during Monday's practice, she didn't feel up to it. But she said after Tuesday, she went to the hospital and she was able to get some medication. And ever since then, she's been better. But that was interesting. I asked her, had she ever been double whammy with not one but two? She says, no, I've never. That's never happened to me. So she's able to make the 3-point play and the Panthers are up by two. So stranger things have happened, right?
Just don't tell me she ate a Chipotle.
I'm sorry, repeat that.
Just don't tell me she ate a Chipotle.
It didn't sound like it, but I guess if she did, that might be cause for another conversation.
They're not sponsoring this time, so I can take the dig. It's well deserved. By the way, for the record, I've eaten at Chipotle several times since the norovirus national outbreak began. I haven't gotten sick. But yeah, sometimes the IV fluids are all you need. That's why major college programs, professional programs that have that kind of budget and that infrastructure will have the ability to give you the IV fluids on the sideline if someone has the flu or has contracted food poisoning and they've got to go. Remember Joe Montana's famous bounce back in one of the Cotton Bowl games that he led Notre Dame to a victory in. He had a raging cold for days leading up to that New Year's Day bowl game. And with some chicken soup and some IV fluids, he led the Irish to a big victory, part of his college mystique.
Two of the future players for both respective teams, Cheyenne Akles for the Panthers and Brianne Nwankwo for the Penguins. Both for sure are the opposing coaches' players of who to watch and who to be careful for.
Franklin had a wide open look there. She'll want to do better with that.
And Akles with the cross is able to get that in to push the lead to four. And a steal almost by Bynum, but she does force it back in the Panthers' favor. So the increased ante of the defense by PCC has forced some early momentum.
This is a 10-0 run for the Panthers. Clark had led at 37-31. Panthers have scored 16-3 in this third quarter to take the 4-point lead.
And Williams, without able to do much by shifting right to left, was able to draw the foul, which puts the foul count at 4 for the Penguins. And Angelique is able to muscle in for another 2.
And Strandberg had to play that straight up without trying for a block because it would have been her third foul if she'd drawn one.
6-point lead, 5:35 in the third quarter. Panthers looking to add to it. And Cheyenne Akles is trying to contest. That was tipped. It was tipped.
Well,
but the referees, I don't think they're buying. Oh, she was able to sell it.
And Akles tried to give the referee the high five. Referees don't like that. You got the call. Everybody on the in the gym is like, hey, you know, you bought that call. Don't try to draw any more attention to yourself by trying to give the referee a high five. I wouldn't recommend that move. Speaking as a official of many years vintage, you're not supposed to show favoritism.
Oh, and Akles is able to come up with that one.
Again, you love the spring in the legs and the hustle. There's another one. But you also want to see a better look at the basket. You're wide open. And a lot of the times what we're seeing here with Isaiah and other players are just thrusting the ball at the rim with both hands. They're not getting the shooting hand behind the ball. I know it's got to be quick, but you have a chance to line up, look at the backboard, see where you want to use the glass to lay it in, and there just has not been that attention to detail on a lot of these close looks.
Bynum at the line, 57% on the year. Misses the first.
It's also the fifth foul of the quarter already on Clark, and they're going to take another stoppage. That leaves Al Aldridge with just two timeouts left this evening.
Well, coming into the game, we had a chance to talk with Coach Aldridge, and he said, Angelique Williams and Cheyenne Akles, you know they're big weapons, so what you want to do is force other players to step up, make them beat us rather than those two. And so far, early in this third, we've seen different instances where other players were able to kind of get their part.
Yeah, Nweku, when she's going well, she'll be able to propel this team to a lot of victories. The same goes for Akles. But neither team has shot the three well today. That's not Akles' game, but it certainly is Nweku's. It certainly is Clark's to be able to shoot the long range two and the three at a better than average clip. And it hasn't been there for them today, and that's made a big difference in the scoreline you see now with PCC in the middle of a 12-0 run and trying to add on to it with the Bynum free throw.
One of the better shooters for this Penguin offense is Brianne Nweku. She's made 5 3-pointers twice this year against Mount Hood Community College and Lower Columbia as Bynum makes that free throw. It's a 7-point lead for the Panthers, 44-37, just coming under 5 minutes.
Great athleticism by Williams to stay in bounds.
And Siva is able to capitalize on the inside. Even though, as Coach Slaughter says, she's green in terms of fundamental, she was able to connect on that one.
Yeah, even just a couple of those layups can make a big difference as she's still learning the game, feeling the game.
And Newsom responds with a three of her own. Trimmed the lead down to 6. 4:15 in this third quarter.
Ends a 15-0 run for Portland.
Newsom again. It's a 4-point game. 46-42. 4:03 in this third. And that prompts a timeout by John Slaughter.
Well, after Portland had gained the big lead, Clark is now winning the transition battle as it had done for a significant part of the first half. Portland's not getting back on defense. Like, they're going to watch the shot go up, not necessarily pursue the rebound or over-pursue it at the offensive end. And there's nobody back there to stop ball. And John Slaughter's probably saying something along those lines in this huddle. Look, this was why the game was beginning to get away with from us in the first half. We weren't getting back. So let's not forget that. Yes, we've hit a few shots. Yes, we're clearly in this game. But let's do ourselves a favor and force Clark to play in the half court where they've been less successful against us.
As the band plays happy in the background, one of the things Coach Lana says is, look, we have to stop the ball and close out. And we have to make them put the ball on the floor. We understand that they're guard heavy and they can burn us, but we have to be smart. And I would suppose that is more the message that he's delivering. As Sierra Stanley, who has checked into the game, will inbound the ball for the Panthers. Four minutes here at O'Connell Sports Complex. Thank you for watching on Portland Sports Network. However you're streaming this, whether it's on iPad, phone, or at home at the desktop, thank you for watching with us. That possession is turned the other way. Angelique Williams is going to get hit with a charging foul.
Well, they look for Newsom again. Said 5 straight points for Clark. Yep, there's a foul from Banks. Yeah, Newsom, that seems to be the pop-out shot, runs the baseline, appears in either corner and takes the three. And she can heat up from there. That will do great things for the Clark Penguins.
And that foul by Banks puts her at number 4, so that will earn her an early trip to the bench as Carpenter is her replacement. Newsom loves that pop-out shot. No good on that one.
Banks, 4th foul by my count, so she sits.
Nichols on a quick release.
Not her shot, and wasn't really even open, so say that's a bit of a wasted possession for Portland.
Tennyson is able to clean up the miss by Cone. Now it's down to a one-possession game, 2:45 in the third quarter.
Now nobody blocked out on the Portland end of things, and Tennyson couldn't have asked for an easier opportunity. It's Nwekwu's third foul as it puts Williams on the line.
Williams, 73% on the year. Good on the first. As we said earlier, Angelique Williams has only played in six games this year, but if there's one thing she can do, and that's put the ball in the basket. She had a season-high 33 against Jamaica. She scored 30 points three times this year and 20 points three times as she did make the second free throw.
I'm sure she'd be happy to share if her teammates are able to give her more help as the season progresses, including tonight.
Bounces out. Panthers ball underneath.
Same call we saw in the first half. When it's two hands reaching up, it's not clear who deflected it out. You tend to give that one to the defense. But yes, Williams' presence on this team takes the Portland Panthers from being a team that probably doesn't go to the playoff tournament to a team that almost definitely could.
Has earned herself another trip to the free throw line tonight.
It's one of two there in the first half. That's the third, by the way, on Tennyson.
So Nwaiko with three and Tennyson with three. That's something I'm sure Coach Aldridge will keep an eye on as this half progresses.
We've got the live stream cooking here at our table, and it's naturally just a couple seconds behind real time. So that's how quick this stream is, folks. You're seeing this in virtually real time.
Possession remains with the Panthers. 2:08 here in the third quarter. Panthers are nesting on a 4-point lead. Referees taking time to confer, make sure the call is correct.
Another number we didn't mention as Williams drives here and misses is the number of free throws each team took in the first half. Clark went 9 of 18, Portland went 2 of 6. And in this quarter, Clark has been called for more fouls, so you can't necessarily say it's been a case of hometown whistles. Clark has just been better at getting to the line.
Swift ball movement by the Penguins, looking for the open crease, and Nwaiko takes advantage of that. By that three-point bucket, it's down to only one, with 1:20 left in the third quarter.
All three of her field goals today have been from beyond 19-9. Got her for 10 points total. Newsom, the leading scorer, with 14 for the Penguins.
And Nwaiko is a person who's not adverse at scoring in double figures. She's done that nine times this season.
Good fight by Stanley, but took too many steps to get out of heavy traffic.
And Siva Isaiah will check in for Cache Bynum.
Getting quality minutes here out of Stanley. She's hustled, she's grabbed rebounds, she's created held balls. She and Carpenter, similar type players, a little different build physically.
She's on the top five in team for rebounding, so she knows how to mix it up inside if need be.
And that's not a bad foul for Carpenter. You know, part of what you want your players farther down in the rotation to do is to take fouls, take some of the defensive pressure off the players who are going to be in for 30, 38 minutes per night like Williams, and when she's ready to go, Akles.
Newsom is able to get inside and put the Penguins back on 49-48.
Now she's been a mixture of drive all the way to the hoop and set up from the corner for three, so she can get you both ways. She's got 17 points now.
8-second differential between shot clock and game clock. Angelique Williams, double dribbles, left to right, and she gets a jump ball. We're going the other way.
I think I'm first on the stat sheet for which of us is talking over the other guy tonight, Paul, so I'll work on that. But here again, this means that Clark has a chance for the last possession.
Reminds me of one of those vaudeville acts, Lewis and Martin, or, you know, Ethel and Bert. It's one of those. We got to work out the kinks.
Yeah, well, which one of us is Martin and which one of us is Lewis? We're going to go right now to Iggy Dah down on the floor. Well, the fourth quarter begins the way the third quarter did, with Clark accumulating fouls. It's now three on Newsom.
Siva Isaiah, a 58% free throw shooter, makes the first. Completes a pair to stem the lead for the Panthers back up by one. Bynum now being placed on Nueko in efforts of getting the ball out of her hands. Siva scrapes for that rebound. Angelique for three. Hits the right part of the rim. Cleared by the Penguins. And Carpenter with another deflection of a pass. Panthers going the other way. Akles gives it to Bynum, but she decides to slow it down.
You like to see Isaiah hit those free throws. We've harped on her for missing layups.
Angelique thought she had an opening, but that was taken away. And Newsom with the step through. 51-50. Now, Penguins hanging on.
Now 18 for Newsom.
How about that basket by Angelique Williams? It's as if it left her hand, but I'm sure she had some control of it, but she gets the and one, and she's earned a trip to the line.
Now 19 for her can make it 20 from the line. So 19 for Williams, 15 for Akles at this stage, 18 for Newsom on the Clark side, 10 for Nweku. And Cohn has knocked in 8, but she has not scored in this second half.
And that one rims out for Williams. That's just what the Penguins wanted, spacing and ball movement. And Strandberg is able to lay it up for 2.
Her first basket of the second half.
Sixteen, 53-52. Penguins hanging on here in this fourth quarter. Thanks once again for those watching on Portland Sports Network. I'm Paul Marshall. That's Scott Armstrong. And the third member of our crew, Iggy. I'll start calling him No ID later, but Iggy Da is the third member.
Portland playing a lot of steals early in this game, and Clark has kind of been suckered into playing the same style. That's led to a lot of reach-in fouls in places where you don't want to give away a foul, such as that one on Strandberg. Good contest there from Tennyson. Make sure Williams didn't get the cleanest look available.
Newsom draws the defense. She's jumping in the corner for joy, perhaps, or for a 3. How about the latter?
She's open, feed her the darn ball. Now 21, so second 3 of the half. Portland cannot afford to leave her alone out there.
Her season high is 24. She had that against Lane, but she scored in double figures 10 times this season as Mary Banks for the Panthers checks in.
This is the largest lead Clark has had since 37-31. Then Portland went on that 15-0 run, and Clark fought their way back into the game as the third period wound down.
And Banks with the swooping right shot.
Banks, again, one of those players, doesn't contribute a lot on the score sheet, but seems to come up with an opportune bucket or a defensive play when you need it.
Another turnover by the Penguins, and the Panthers will have a chance to tie or take the lead with 7:04 remaining in the fourth.
That's a fortunate foul there, as cutting Williams had lost control of the pass. But again, climbing high in the foul count, if you're Clark, is not necessarily the worst thing. Depends on who you're going to put on the line. If it's going to be Akles, for instance, you know she's not a good free throw shooter.
That foul count continues to rise for the Penguins as Banks is now stepping to the line. Banks, a 46% shooter on the year, clinks out the first.
And Alecki has to go get Strandberg because she's just picked up her 4th. So she's the first player with 4 for Clark, Banks with 4 for Portland.
Alecki and Nweku, high school teammates, one of several on tonight's contest. Banks misses both 1 and 2. And Newsom is able to pro-step her way for another deuce.
And Stanley tried for a charge there, but it just wasn't there. Stanley was also pretty far underneath the basket.
Ankles behind the back. Has that poked away? And Stanley rips that, and that pass is deflected.
Bynum was not about to let Newsom score. Portland group wanted to travel, and then they wanted a violation against Newsom for picking the ball up with her feet.
Newsom, a 67% shooter on the year, a sophomore from Grant High School, one of a few Oregonians on this final roster. Good on the first.
She's been solid at the line today as well. I have her for 4 or 5 with another coming.
Alecki's earned herself a trip to the line. Season high, 11 points against Centralia, as well as 10 rebounds against Pierce. So although her stats may not be as fitting, she's able to get her numbers when she's in the game. An 81% shooter, and that shows right there as Siva Isaiah comes in, switches on the right block for Angelique Williams.
And I'd expect the A lineup for Slaughter the rest of the way. And Aldridge will probably do the same here in a minute or two. Regardless of foul problems, he'll get his best 5 out there.
And you can see the fans dabbing in appreciation of the free throw shooting that was on point for both attempts.
You're going to have to teach me that, right, Paul? Thanks.
I will do no such thing.
No.
I'll tell you when I dab, because I'm about to sneeze.
There's another miss on a layup there by Isaiah, and then foul heading the other way.
Under 6 minutes, Clark leads 61-54. First time these two teams have played in the South Division. Previously, the Clark Penguins have always been in the West. But this marks the first time the one of two meetings that these two teams will face.
Right there, Eagles has got to try to play under control as there's a reach in against Williams to stop the fast break. You like the way she explodes across the court, tries to gain separation from defenders, but then when you've got the open layup, you've got to have enough body control to just drop it in, use the glass if necessary.
The Penguins on the year, 10-5 with an overall record, 2-1 in the division. The Panthers, on the other hand, 2-11, but 1-2 within the South Division. As we said earlier, that these teams will meet again. This time the Panthers are on the road. Nice pass for Newsom. Is it a surprise? She scores again inside.
Alecki with the very unselfish play. She could have taken it herself, but she understood Newsom had momentum to the basket.
Coming up on 5 minutes, Penguins looking to maintain control of this lead.
So they've widened it back out to the lead they had at halftime, a 9-point lead at 34-25.
Pass saved. As the crowd stopped in silence to hear what the call was, but it's a pair of free throws for Angelique Williams.
And looking at our live stream, which is a few seconds behind real time for us, you could have gotten either Nweku or Cone on that foul. The officials chose Cone. Nweku already has 3.
.63-55, .4.39 here in this final quarter. A reminder, at the conclusion of this game, the men will take on Clark College. Scott Armstrong and Paul Marshall will again be on that call. And yes, I did speak myself in third person, but it's just one of those days, and it kind of goes where it may.
As Carl Rove would say, when you're explaining, you're losing. Well, the explaining going on in these two huddles is about Clark holding on to the basketball, maintaining this lead. Obviously, they want the offense to flow through Kaylee Newsom, who has had a wonderful evening. Has had trouble shooting from distance, but when she has cut to the basket, she's been very tough to stop for the Portland defense. Meantime, in the Portland huddle, you're looking for possessions that are under control. There is a lot of time left, and It's important to convert the open looks that you get. Not a huge three-point shooting team. Yes, we've seen Banks dump one in from distance now and again, but you want to have quality, under control possessions. That's how you're going to cut into this lead. And maybe a couple of steals wouldn't hurt either, the kind that we saw Williams and Akles come up with in the first half.
And on this end, we see the men going into the locker room to get ready for their contest with PCC. I guess that would be act two of this opening act for the play that is PCC versus Clark College. 63-56, 4:30 remaining in the fourth.
Williams now at 21.
Siva got caught behind Alecki, and Alecki will earn another trip to the line.
Alecki's first miss of the day. She'd gone 4-4 up until then, but Clark has gotten to the line a lot more often, and that's always a big difference in any game.
Makes the second, but not the first. So her student section had to wait for the second free throw. Aiko was able to get out of a corner.
Yeah, Williams again just throwing up that three. She doesn't shoot it consistently enough for me to say that that's a good shot for the Portland offense ever. I mean, having watched her for a few games now, she's got to get more consistent with it or she shouldn't take it.
Molly Franklin reigns into three.
And that could well be the dagger. Still got over 3.5 to play, but that is Clark's largest lead of the second half.
Only shooting 26% from downtown. She gets that as Siva Isaiah counters with a layup of her own. Panthers not out of this one yet. 67-58, 3:20 left in the fourth.
That was the heat check on the part of Franklin. If that one goes down, that's also a killer, but Portland able to come up with the rebound.
Angelique overshoots the rim on that layup.
And you can tell there's maybe a half step lost over all the minutes she has to play in the course of a game. She does not take breaks generally. And it was some effort for her after missing that layup to turn and head back on defense. And that's not saying she's dogging it. It's just very tough to ask any player to play that portion of the 40 minutes.
See the Isaiah batted away that pass, and that went behind the scenes where our camera crew had to rustle up and retrieve the ball, which is a reason for the delayed game action.
Good anticipation there by Williams, again trying to conserve her energy here with 3 minutes to go, but anticipating that they were going to look for the corner three off the inbound.
Speaking of retrieving game action, I meant to commend you the other day, or earlier today, either. The ball bounced right behind the curtain, and you were quick to get on it. So two snaps and a twist, I guess.
I'd say it's because I look more athletic than I am, but that's a lie. The volume score, but again, some of these shots, you just would like to see a little more consistency and form. It's getting open.
Monique Washington with the southpaw layup to push the lead to 11. Coming up on 2:20 left in this remaining quarter. Barbara Leone waits at the scorer's table as she was responsible for a couple of early three-point barrages. And she will check into the game now.
Yeah, fatigue becoming a factor here for Portland. It already has. And you're beginning to see the possessions are a little more sloppy. In the middle of this second half, some crispness. Akles was driving the bus on certain offensive possessions, but now you see Portland with hands on hips trying to sustain energy, and Clark is able to really milk the clock here, and they should do that.
Carpenter has also checked into the game for the Panthers. Rebound, Penguins. Tennyson from Anchorage, Alaska, will be shooting too.
I'm sure anybody who talks to her on campus or whatnot around the Vancouver, Washington area, like, hey, this weather's been kind of rough here this winter. She's like, you don't know what you're talking about. Guess what I got to grow up with. But of all the Alaskans I know, they love their climate, and they are very much accustomed to it. And it's really impossible, any Alaskan that I've ever met, and maybe Tennyson would say the same, it's impossible for any Alaskan to be too cold. They're not people who get cold very easily.
Makes a second. Isaiah and Williams have checked into the game for the Panthers.
And that may have sealed it. Now I would say if Williams is open for three, she should hoist it because they've got to go in if Portland has any chance of getting back in the game.
And that shot is able to hit the rim but not stay down for Cheyenne Akers. Nueka was going to pull the trigger, but she decided to pull it out and read the floor. And Carpenter takes that.
It's a tough reach on the part of Tennyson because you're allowing Portland to score with the clock stopped. Both teams well into the bonus by now. There again, Carpenter has come up with a few of those steals. She reads that perimeter pass well, and Clark makes it easier for her by making it a flat pass across on the skip. You're trying to spread the floor and keep the ball there. You don't want to throw a long pass that has a better chance of being picked off. Tough miss for Williams, though, who's been pretty reliable from the line today. I think those are tired misses. As I said earlier, it's not that she isn't giving max effort, but it's tough to ask your highest scorer to play 37 minutes and not feel it at the end of regulation. It's often why they go ahead, Paul.
Looking to spread it out.
Biggest team in the conference. But I bring it back to the number of open looks at the rim that have been missed by both teams, but especially Portland. In the first half, it was more of a problem for Clark. Portland's a team that shoots 30, 33%, maybe 35% on a good day. Clark's a better shooting team from the field, and so they were a little off. They hit a few key threes in this half, especially when Newsom began to get hot. And so they've been able to ride her hot hand through the second half and gain separation. But when it comes to Portland, you've just got to take advantage of the opportunities afforded you. And too many missed layups have, again, put them in deep trouble here with less than a minute to play.
And that ball is stolen away from Angelique Williams. 45 seconds remaining in the game. As you pointed out earlier, fatigue, that shot wasn't even close to the rim as she would have anticipated.
There's only so much you can ask one player to do, and Akers and Williams have accounted for nearly 40 points of Portland's entire output, but who is going to be that third role player that gets them there? And there have been a few drips and drops offensively, some spot up threes, but teams plan for that. Teams see on film that you've got a couple of players who, when they're completely set, their feet in the right position, they get a good catch off the pass, they're going to make the three. Well, in game speed, you can't rely on that. So Portland's lacking that third scorer that could really put them in the mix in the South Division.
Molly Franklin comes away with a pair. 38 seconds remaining in this game. Reminder, at the conclusion of this one, the men will take on Clark College, and that will be 7:30 again on Portland Sports Network. Myself and Scott will have the call, and the third member of our crew, Iggy, will also be with us. So stay tuned for that one.
I'm not planning to go anywhere, at any rate. Bynum is fouled out here.
Banks will be her replacement.
And one of the things I like about Nweku is that she's got the proper countenance for this sport. There's not a lot of negative body language. I mean, even now, a free throw that she knows is not critical to the outcome of the game, she's still loose. And that's really the way she's played these 40 minutes. And it also takes a pretty loose player to chew gum in basketball. Not a lot of your more intense types can work the gum for 40 minutes. Jordan did it.
I always felt bad for the gum when Gary Payton chewed it, like he was hurting it in more ways than one.
Exactly.
And that Isaiah bucket will count, but that's your final score. Clark defeats PCC 64-60. So these two teams will meet again, and this time, for the first time, that the Clark College Penguins are in the same region. These games now mean more than anything, as the Penguins now move to 3-1 in division, while the Panthers drop to 1-3 in the division. Coming up next, the men take on Clark College Penguins for the Portland Community College Panthers. Again, if you're watching on Portland Sports Network, don't go anywhere. Scott Armstrong and myself and Iggy Day will have the call.
Oh. Hey, guys.
We get camera time. That's really cool.
Well, as a guy with a face for radio, I sort of see this as a 50-50 proposition.
Radio.
But again, what you saw in the second half, here, let me move my microphone over here. Get your whole face in the shot, Paul. Come on. What you saw in the second half was Clark playing Clark basketball. That's what you wanted to see. Al Aldridge did not see that from his team in the first half. And John Slaughter's team is always max effort. But at the beginning of the fourth quarter, in the later stages of the fourth quarter, they begin to wear down. They just don't have the same rotation. They don't have the same size. And their best player, Angelique Williams, is just not able to get to the rim or shoot from long distance with the same force and the same accuracy as you'll see in the early stages of the game. So she scores a lot of points, but there's only so much you can hope
and
for from
end,
her.
Coach Aldridge said, we're going to look for other people to beat us. And that didn't happen. That, so much to say, started early, but it fizzled off towards the end. And the balanced attack of Clark, they were able to get, you know, Nweku and Newsom. They were able to get their shots, but other people were able to chip in as well. And again, as we stated earlier, it's really tough when you have one person, or in this case, two, shouldering the load. But that was the case today.
Yeah, who is the third scorer for Portland going to be as the season moves toward tournament? Still got a month and a half before Portland can crack into the tournament. Clark, I would expect to be there, even with switching divisions, even with as dominant as Lane has been for the last couple of years. But Clark played the way they can play in the second half. They didn't play down to Portland in terms of the game getting into a sort of a transition skirmish.
And for the first time, now that both teams have played in the same division, as we said earlier, these games mean that much more, as we're just under 16 minutes as the men have taken the floor for their warm-ups. But this loss by the PCC Panthers, it doesn't put them out of contention for playoffs, but it does make that road a little bit harder. But stay tuned with us from Portland Sports Network. We have second game action coming up. The men take on Clark College here on Portland Sports Network.
Find another one, there should be one.